fine political reporter for National Review Online, Joel Gehrke, taking time out of his morning for us. Joel, good morning to you.
Good morning. How are you?
We're doing very well. Thanks for being on with us. We're curious about what kind of slugfest is going on behind the scenes in the House.
There's a lot going around the majority leader's race. The Speaker's race is tough to figure in one sense and another. It's very easy. House Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy is the heavyweight in that fight. He's, you know, all but got Boehner's endorsement. He's, you know, one member told me that he thought he had 125 votes of Republicans locked up, another maybe as much as 180. There's only one other candidate in the race who hasn't really caught fire. The difficulty for him, for McCarthy, is that he's got the same problem that Speaker Boehner had, mm-hmm. which is to be the Speaker of the House, you've got to win a vote on the House floor, and there are going to be 188 Democrats who vote against you, and that means he can only afford to lose so many Republicans, like 29 Republicans. And so there's this group of conservative hardliners who are trying to win some changes, and so they could vote against him on the House floor, at which point there would be chaos. But assuming that he wins, the real fight is shaping up on the House side, on the majority leader's side, and who would replace McCarthy, and that's between Tom Price and the House Budget Committee Chairman and the current whip, Steve Scalise. And that's an interesting one, because that's kind of a heavyweight fight. It's close. There are sort of policy differences between them that are affecting the race, plus it's sort of shaping up as a conservative versus establishment race. So that's where a lot of the drama will be.
Which of those, this is a real question, which of those guys is the establishment, which of those guys is the conservative? I kind of thought of both Steve Scalise and Tom Price as having pretty good relations and being relative conservatives in the House.
Well, fairly or not, certainly they're, you don't get to be a chairman of a committee by being too much of a bomb thrower, but Tom Price, certainly has a reputation as a fiscal hawk who is serious about trying to get the country's finances under control and very principled. So there are some people who see him as a counterweight to the typical, a potential counterweight to the way leadership typically does things. On the other hand, Scalise is regarded, fairly or not, as having gone native in leadership since he became majority whip. He was elected to bring conservatives along, the theory being that he had good relationships with conservatives, but in practice, a member of the moderate Tuesday group caucus, at least, tells me that, he's moved to the center, and so the real moderates in the conference like him a lot more than they used to. So then just the simple phenomenon that he was already in leadership. He was part of the status quo when Boehner stepped down. So that sort of adds to it. And so we saw Paul Ryan and Jeb Hensarling endorse Tom Price. And on the apparent theory that he would help kind of shake up the leadership dynamic.
Yeah, when I had read that there was a reason that he didn't go further than whip was, he had trouble mustering some of the other more conservative members, and as you had mentioned, it's because what? He's become part of the Washington establishment in their eyes?
Well, I think in fairness to him, it's because he's the whip. He's not the guy who makes policy. and so whatever the policies are that the other folks didn't, that the conservatives didn't like, he is, it's his job to go sell the plan that John Boehner or Kevin McCarthy or whoever comes up with. And so that's a difficult job. On the other hand, it was always sort of understood that Lee is a conservative, but he wasn't quite regarded as the Jim Jordan, you know, I don't want to say hardline, but his plan wasn't to challenge leadership a lot, at least his reputation. He didn't have a reputation as somebody who challenged leadership. He had a reputation as somebody who was hoping to move up in leadership and being more collaborative with them. So you know, whether that led to a fair assessment of him or not by his colleagues, the end result is that he's the leadership guy, and Tom Price is the one, you know, who has the backing of, say, a Jeb Hensling or Paul Ryan trying to move in.
Joel Gehrke with us from National Review Online, nationalreview.com. You can read his piece there. GOP meeting resolves nothing as leadership fights brew. It's Riley and Scott on WROK. Now, the majority whip position, Joel, Peter Roskam said he's not going for it this time. Kathy McMorris Rogers took her name out of the running. Could Steve Scalise retain that majority whip position? Congressman Pete Sessions from Texas also is interested, correct?
Yeah, and so under current House rules, or the rules of the House Republican Conference, everybody who has a position right now keeps it. There's only one race officially. There is a speaker's race. The whole majority leader thing we just discussed only happens if McCarthy officially wins and moves up. That applies down the line. The majority leader's race, there only becomes a whip race if Scalise wins the majority leader's race, and then there, you know, and so on. Some discussion of changing that rule, but it's hard to gauge yet how much appetite there is for that, because some folks would certainly have an incentive for wanting it changed.
Sure.
Other folks would not, and then it sort of depends on the mass of people, depends on whether the implementation would make things more or less confusing, and it's just not clear yet. But if we assume that the rule stays the way it is, it's a factor that could favor Scalise in the majority leader's race, because everybody who hopes to be whip needs him to win.
Joel Gehrke with us from National Review, nationalreview.com. Let's go back to the speaker slot for a moment, Joel. Kevin McCarthy, again, looks like a good bet to win that role. How does anything, or does anything, change in the House under the leadership of a Speaker McCarthy?
It depends. First of all, I guess it's not clear what would change. But McCarthy is regarded as a little more moderate than Boehner. On the merits of their kind of voting record or temperament. But he also, at least the way he's been talking, he's given voice to a greater willingness to be aggressive in terms of the messaging strategy and pressing, making it difficult for Democrats. I'm thinking right now back during the fight to defund President Obama's executive orders on amnesty and other things. The House Republicans had passed legislation on that, and Democrats were just filibustering it. And so the stories coming out of House leadership meetings were about how McCarthy was, Boehner was keeping quiet, but McCarthy was arguing volubly for how we can't just let ourselves get rolled by the Senate here. We're an institution that's done this thing, and we need to put pressure on them. On the one hand, that could be a good cop routine that he was doing. On the other hand, because he is still Painter's leadership team then, and on the other hand, whether or not it was, it's still, it's giving voice to the kinds of strategic concerns that the hardliners who've been frustrated with Boehner have. Because those concerns aren't just directed at Boehner. There's sort of this growing frustration or ongoing frustration that people seem to say on the front, up front, we're not going to be able to win this fight because Democrats can filibuster or because Obama can veto. And so McCarthy was talking like somebody who didn't want to play these fights that way.
You're not reading Joel Gehrke stuff. You're missing out on a lot. Follow him at nationalreview.com. Get on him on Twitter as well. You'll learn a whole lot. Joel, we really appreciate you taking time out of your morning for us.
Hey, thank you.